Hi folks, Ryan Honeyman here from Lyft Economy. Many folks have come to us over the last 10 years and asked, how do I get more involved in creating an economy that works for the benefit of all life? They also ask, what skills and experiences do I need to help make this transition? So 3 years ago, we created something called the Next Economy MBA to help address this and similar questions. Lyft Economy's Next Economy MBA is an online course that's designed for entrepreneurs, aspiring entrepreneurs, students, recent graduates, employees, and folks who want to learn more about transformational next economy strategies and businesses. Join the growing alumni network of nearly 250 alumni who've gone through this program and learned essential skills and hopefully built lifelong relationships for catalyzing businesses in the emergent and regenerative economy. So we encourage you to check out our course. You can go to lyfteconomy.com/MBA. The next course, Cohort 7, starts on September 21st, 2021. So once again, go to www.lyfteconomy.com/MBA. And now, on with the show. Welcome to Next Economy Now. The goal of this podcast series is to highlight the leaders who are taking a regenerative, bioregional, equitable, democratic, racially just, and whole systems approach to creating the new economy.
Lyla, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me.
Lyla, I'd love to introduce our listeners to your story. And so can you give us a little bit of background as to how you got into some of the work you're doing today?
That's a big question. But well, I was born and raised in Taos, New Mexico, to parents who were always teaching me about what Indigenous peoples had gone through on this land and what we needed to do in order to restore harmony. And so a lot of my upbringing has been informed by Indigenous science and Indigenous rights advocacy. And then I also went to Stanford University, where I studied environmental anthropology, where I got to really marinate on a lot of ideas of Indigenous cultural diversity and how that relates to biodiversity. And I also studied American Indian Education, is the name of the concentration at the University of New Mexico, where I studied how do we transmit knowledge, Indigenous knowledge, from one generation to another of, for, and by Indigenous peoples. How do we create those education systems? And currently I'm working on my PhD at the University of Alaska Fairbanks, where I'm looking into Indigenous land management and Indigenous food systems. And economics, I've always kind of dabbled in that. And I think that's obviously something we have to engage if we are to transform our society. And so I've studied a lot of what some people call indigenomics and Indigenous perspectives on what people in English call economy, and just in general been sort of one half theorist and the other half community organizer and community advocate. So yeah, I guess that's how I could answer that in a nutshell.
And in all the different things that you're involved with, what are you most excited about right now? What's giving you the most energy?
Probably my PhD, because we're gearing up to create experiments where we try to transmit traditional ecological knowledge to the next generation and looking at how that happens and how we can improve that process so that when the world starts to return the land back to Indigenous peoples, as we are starting to see happen, you are also, we as Indigenous peoples are also going to be ready and have the skills and the capacity to return not only the land to Indigenous peoples, but return the Indigenous stewardship practices to the land. And so that's really what I'm probably most excited about right now. I also just finished running for office here in New Mexico, which was incredibly eye-opening in a lot of ways and challenging and instructive in so many ways. And so that was a big thing that I'm kind of coming off of right now.
Yeah. Could you talk a little bit about that? I mean, you know, I think you were running against the incumbent, and like just maybe a little background on what, like why you got into the race and sort of some of the, you know, the 7-day fast and stuff like that. I'm sure people would be interested to hear that.
In New Mexico, I was running for a state level government. I was running against the Speaker of the House for the state of New Mexico. And this candidate received maxed out donations from ConocoPhillips, from Marathon Oil, pharmaceutical companies, casinos, and so was very much, in my opinion, intertwined with these industries. And so I was really trying to bring a grassroots campaign. We had donations flow in from all 50 states across the country because I was really addressing the issue of the Permian Basin, which is in southern New Mexico, which is the largest oil producer in the world right now. It's a fracking hotspot and a methane hotspot. And so I was really trying to draw attention to how tragically New Mexico is failing at being a responsible climate champion in the face of the climate crisis. So, and I did a 7-day fast on the Capitol steps just to pray for the next 7 generations to come. And it ended up ending in a pretty ugly way. And a lot of, in my opinion, I was kind of bullied out of the race. But I guess that's what happens when you challenge the status quo, is a lot of people come out of the woodwork to defend it. But we are redirecting all of the funding from the campaign to the Youth United for Climate Crisis Action here in New Mexico. And with that funding, we will be pressuring candidates statewide to see if they will be pledging to climate action or not. And then through that, creating voters' guides for New Mexicans. So it's kind of a good silver lining at the end of the day, because now we're not just affecting my candidacy, but candidates statewide. So we feel good about it. And we feel like this might have been the more powerful place to work from the beginning.
So it's not like you're already gearing up for your next race. You're sort of like, let's shift strategies a little bit. Is that kind of what you're thinking?
Yeah, we didn't skip a beat, really. We just jumped. It's still the climate work. It's still the same work and probably more powerful work. And it will continue to influence policy throughout the state. So yeah, we're not really stopped. We're just changing form.
So the way that I initially found out about your work was, I'm part of a course called Before We Were White by the organization White Awake. And as part of the reading of the course, we were asked to read your very beautiful article entitled The Story of How Humanity Fell in Love with Itself Once Again. And I'm wondering if you could give a little bit of the background to sort of like that article, and then sort of give folks some of the content about what you talked about.
Yeah, my mom is mostly 100% indigenous to this continent genetically. She has one great grandfather who was Jewish. So I have a great great grandfather who's Jewish on her side. But the rest, she is a Diné or Navajo. My father's side is kind of the inverse. He's mostly European, but he does have some indigenous ancestors, particularly from Southern Cheyenne. I grew up kind of as this part native, part European being, and it was really challenging to reconcile my two sides because historically they were at war, or rather historically one of them was committed genocide on the other. So it was very hard to understand who I was and what my place was. So the way I coped with it was I just pretended I was 100% Native American. I just never even acknowledged my European side because I didn't want to be associated with those that committed genocide. But as I dug deeper, I started to realize that there's a lot of beauty in my European heritage, and there's a lot of important things to remember about that. And so funnily enough, my Diné elders are the ones who kind of shepherded me back to my European ancestors and said, hey, you have to honor all your clans, not just your Diné ones. And so as I was praying and delving into that, I started to feel my European ancestors more strongly. And I went back to Europe and I was held by the mountains there. And I started to pray there and I started to feel there. And then that feeling that is not necessarily able to be intellectualized was coupled with some, you know, more intellectual research about the witch burnings, the Roman expansion, the Inquisition, the destruction of the Welsh and the Gaelic and the Celtic nations, and really looking into the Black Death and the bubonic plague, which wiped out a large fraction of Europe overnight, and really looking at the treatment of women and basically realizing that Europeans were a lot like Native Americans, had gone through all the same stuff. And then I realized that what happened here on this continent of what we now call the United States was really just a perpetuation of what occurred in Europe. And Europe was the testing ground for a lot of these colonizing strategies. That's really what I realized, was that not only was it okay to be European, but it was actually incredibly beautiful. And that there was a lot of gorgeous parts of our people before the conquest and before the blood and before the war that ravaged Europe for thousands of years. For instance, they found a clay figurine in German soil back in 2009. And this clay figurine was of a woman. And it's believed to represent the sanctity of the feminine, the sanctity of the earth, and the sanctity of life itself. And it was dated to be 40,000 years old. And so we start to see how long, you know, that these European ancestors were molding clay with their hands as an offering and as a almost like a form of prayer for the earth and for the feminine and for life. And that sounds really like what Indigenous peoples do here. And then realizing that the Welsh language was actually illegalized and prohibited in schools. And if you got caught speaking Welsh, you got a block of wood tied around your neck, which had the letters WN written on it. And the only way you could get this block of wood off of your neck is if you caught another kid speaking Welsh. And so these ways that the Welsh language was tried to be eradicated was very similar to what happened to my mom's people. I just started to see the similarities. But one of the most striking ones, of course, is how the women were treated. For my Navajo side, you know, we were put in a concentration camp for 4 years, just not that long ago in 1864, and thousands of us died in this concentration camp. And Hitler is said to have studied this camp to create his own. And in this camp, the women were systematically raped because they had no water. And so if they wanted water for their children, they'd have to go to the soldiers' barracks and basically get raped, and then they would get water for their children. And so similarly, in Europe, you have the men were tied up and couldn't do anything to protect the women because they were at gunpoint. And so you're not just hurting the women, you're hurting the men who love them, and you're not breaking their bodies, you're breaking their spirits, because the women feel bad that they've been raped. They blame themselves. They feel icky. And then the men feel bad because they feel like they failed to protect. And so it just obliterates the whole population. It's a psychological, spiritual form of warfare. And so you also have that in Europe with the destruction of the witches, right? Imagine getting your mom burned, seeing your mom burned alive, your niece burned alive, your own daughter burned alive, your wife burned alive. As a man, that breaks you in such a profound way. And clearly as a woman, you get burned alive. And so it's not fun for anyone. And so I started to see how not only is it important for us to not dress up as Native Americans on Halloween, it's actually not appropriate for us to dress up as witches on Halloween, because to trivialize and even continue to misrepresent what these women were, you know, these were the women who understood the rocks and the mountains and herbs, and they understood the songs and understood the traditional ecological knowledge and the traditional ecological healing modalities. And of course, you see all of this demonized and twisted into being something evil, which is exactly what they did to Native Americans. You know, we were heathens, we were savages, we were devil worshipers, when really we were just trying to pray for all the earth and for balance of life on earth. And so, like, we're not doing anything. We just want everything to be healthy. And so it's just very, very, very similar. It's just, the problem is that the other one happened 2,000 years earlier. So there's a dissonance. And so people forget quickly, and they don't realize that Native Americans and Europeans have been through nearly identical processes of colonization, assimilation, and cultural destruction.
And I think you, on the course in your talk, after, you know, we read your piece and then in the talk, you spoke about, you know, it's not lost on you that being an Indigenous woman and saying this, it's sort of like another way that Indigenous folks are like helping, quote unquote, Europeans like reconnect with their own roots. Because you were saying, like, if I was a white woman and I said that, it wouldn't have the same resonance. Can you speak to that at all? Or
yeah, I think I'm in a unique position to say all of this, because as a Native American woman validating the indigenousness of European Americans, that does mean something different than a fully white woman saying, you know, we are Indigenous. It also has an element of forgiveness wrapped into it, right? Because what happened to Native Americans was so profoundly brutal that we are all having a hard time making peace out of that severity that continues today of destruction and oppression. And so for a Native person to say, hey, look, maybe these people didn't mean to do this to us. Maybe they were recovering from 2,000 years of terror that they had just undergone. You know, it's sort of like me. When I was 20 years old, I was a drug addict. I was a kleptomaniac. I was not a healthy person to be around. I was harmful to society. And if you just saw me, walked up to me that day, you'd probably think I was a horrible person. But what the elders ended up doing to me was they said, hey, wait a second. Look at what you were born into. You were born into a home of drugs and alcohol and drug dealing. You started doing drugs when you were 11 years old. Your basketball coach got you drunk when you were 12. You know, like, is this really a bad person? Or was she trained to not know what was up, what was down? Was she trained to hate herself? Is her addiction really just a form of self-destruction and self-punishment? Because, and not to mention, I was sexually abused more times than I can count since I was very young. And so, you know, that's what I mean. Like, that type of grace and that type of understanding, deep understanding, is really important for us to have in this time. And so I kind of applied that same logic to European Americans and say, hey, wait a second. Are white people really all just mean, supremacist, monstrous beings? Are they recovering from the destruction of their own languages, the destruction of their own feminine spirit, the destruction of their own lands, and the abuse of men by other men? You know, rape from men to men was very common in the Roman Empire, just the absolute destruction of their spirits. And so, you know, I think that element of forgiveness is something that would be different coming from a Native American woman than if it was coming from a white woman to say, you know, hey, I don't hold this stuff against you. You know, let's, which not all of my peers agree with me on that. I should be clear. I'm not necessarily the most popular philosopher on these things, but oftentimes grace isn't popular. Punitive justice is more popular because you get that revenge, right? But in this sense, I don't believe in any sense ever anywhere. I don't believe in punitive justice. I believe in restorative justice and looking at what people have gone through and then realizing that what happened to them and through them as a result wasn't actually their fault.
Yeah, and thank the God or creator for having access to elders too for you. I think that's another piece we're missing in European lineage society is like, who are those wisdom keepers? Like grandparents sometimes, but yeah.
Well, and acknowledging that that was very an articulated move to destroy those elders. Mm. When the British army came into Scotland, they would kill the bards first, and the bards were the storytellers and the song keepers, and they would bury them face down so that their stories would die with them. And so this is the type of intentional destruction of European knowledge, Indigenous knowledge, and also you have in the year 1243, I think it was, that King Edward I massacred over 100 Celtic harpists. And so there is a very articulated destruction of European Indigenous culture happening throughout the first and second millennia of this era. And so you really, again, it's basically what the boarding schools did to Native Americans and destroying our languages, our culture, is just a repeat of what happened in Europe.
Are there any books or other resources you could point any listeners who are sort of interested in that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, you can always Google my article, which, yes, I think it has different titles in different places. But one of them is The Story of How Humanity Fell in Love with Itself Once Again, because I couldn't find a shorter title. Yep. And then another one is The Chalice and the Blade. And The Chalice and the Blade is a very detailed archaeological survey of how, but it's also not just overly scientific. There's also some prose and philosophical ideas in there, but how Europe went transformed from a chalice culture, which is the chalice is a symbol of abundance and community and unity, to a blade culture, which is a symbol of fortification, defense, zero-sum mentalities. And so she basically starts to recognize when fortified cities started coming about in Europe and how Europe transformed from a goddess culture to a culture of war. That's a good one to read. There's also one called the Malleus Maleficarum, I believe it's called. And it is the official book for how to find out if a woman is a witch or not. It's an ancient text, not that ancient, maybe 1,000 years old, but it's an older text that people would use to see if a woman was a witch or not. And a lot of what's written in this book is about how women would seduce men with their witch powers and force them to have sex with them, which clearly you can read between the lines. These guys raped a woman and then called her a witch because, oh, she seduced me to rape her. You know, so those are things to think about. You also have Boudica, Boudica. She was a leader in what is now the United Kingdom, and she forced the Roman army out of the islands. And she was a female army general of sorts, and she is an important figure in Indigenous European history. I know that there's like fiction books about her, but there's also just lots of other historical books about her. Yeah, I could go on, but there's just Google war in Spain, yeah, and you'll see hundreds of periods of documented bloodshed, you know, that give rise to people like, you know, Ponce de Leon, give rise to people like Hernan Cortez, give rise to all these conquistadors that came over here and perpetuated that trauma onto us.
Do you find, like, I remember in the talk you gave, you spoke about, is your dad's side, there's just some Scandinavian ancestry?
Yes.
Do you think it's important to know, like, I came from like lowland Scotland and this specific region, or is it more of like, we should know like more of the general, I mean, both, but like, because we've sort of adopted, even if I wasn't, say, Scandinavian specifically, that may have been influencing as part of being a white person or someone of European ancestry. How do you see the, like, how specific you should look to your roots, like within Europe, if that is your ancestry?
Listen, I think that the important thing here is to grieve that we even have to ask that question. That we, the task here is to grieve and to cry and to feel that why don't we know where we're from? Why don't we? And the reason is, you know, that was deliberate. That was a deliberate destruction of our connection to our ancestors and our ancestral homeland by various forces. But all of these forces were moved by a negative spirit. And that negative spirit is really the one to blame. If you're going to blame someone, is when we are in fear, that negative spirit can use us to harm others. And so that spirit, its goal is to detach human beings from their connection to their creator. And the culture, when it is intact and when it is healthy, that culture is the medium through which we connect to creator. And so if you can destroy the culture, you can destroy a whole people's connection to creator. And when you do that, then they become lost. And so, and then you can enlist them in the negative spirit much more easily because they don't have any means of connection. And so I think the important thing is to grieve, you know, that was deliberately, brutally, violently ripped and tortured away from us as European peoples. And to grieve that so that we can then be more aware of what we're feeling and what we're healing from, and then we can let it go. Now, for those of us who do have some way of knowing what part of the land we are from, you know, I think obviously the more precise, the better. But at the same time, if you don't have that precise understanding of where your great-grandmother is from, or where your great-great-great-grandmother is from, or where her great-grandparents are from, or where your great-great-great-grandpa is from, you know, if you don't have that precision, which again is intentional that we don't have that, then you can always pray your way there. Let me give you an example. I had a prayer to reconnect with my Indigenous European ancestry. And so I have always been interested in that. And I get an invitation to go to Devon, England to teach a class at this place called Schumacher College. So I go to Devon, England. We film a music video there about, you know, my song about Indigenous Europe, Mamolad song. We do all this stuff. I teach the class. I go back home. A few months ago, I was sitting with my aunties and we were looking at a family book. And lo and behold, this book says the Sweet family house is in Devon, England. And I was just like, what? Crazy. So things like that have happened for me in the past. I also went through Texas. And I was just really, for some reason, I wanted to stay in this place called Childress, Texas. I was on my way to see my auntie in Nacogdoches, Texas, because my dad's from Texas. And I stopped in Childress, and I thought, what is there to do around here? And I see that there's this thing called the Indian Mounds. And I'm like, well, that sounds like a really bastardized understanding of what these sacred places used to be. So I went there. It was powerful. I could feel the ancestors there. And it was a Kiowa sacred site, and the Kiowa had all been driven out a long time ago. Then I go to my auntie's house, and she says, oh, you know, I went there to learn about our family history. And she said, oh, yeah, so, well, your grandpa was, or your great-grandpa was a preacher in this random little town called Childress. And I just was like, wow, I stayed in the same town that my great-grandpa was a preacher in. And so to me, that I don't think that's a coincidence. I don't think that I coincidentally found those mounds. I don't think it's a coincidence that I was drawn to them. And I think it's, I know, you know, everyone and their mom would say I'm crazy, but I think it's plausible that I have ancestry from those lands and those people. Why would they call me back there? So anyways, my point is, if you don't have the ancestry.com answer to like, where are you from? You can always get that answer through your prayer and through your openness to receive the answers to those prayers.
I love that answer because something we need to hear. Well, I, you know, one of the questions we often ask folks is, what can listeners do who are, you know, listening to this and you want to get involved in either some of the work you're doing or some of the initiatives, but we generally offer support to the guests of the podcast to say, like, what are some ways that listeners in our community can help you build this next economy? Is there anything that comes to mind for ways that folks can support your work?
That's a great question. I'm still in the process of kind of building the plan, but my plan is to create an Indigenous university where we transmit the knowledge of our ancestors to the next generation. And from the elders, start getting that knowledge flowing, because our elders are dropping very quickly and our languages are going to die if we don't do something more drastic. And so I think once I have my PhD finished and we start to lay the groundwork for that, we can start to bring in more funding and more networking and more assistance with that. And the goal is, like I said, to allow, like, land is being repatriated and rematriated, is starting to be. I've had a few white folks say, hey, who can I give this land to? And that's really cool. And at the same time, we need to be building up capacity among Indigenous youth to be ready to receive that land in a good way and to know what to do with it, because a lot of our knowledge has been lost and Native youth are not given the understanding of how to reverse the effects of the boarding schools on in our community. So I think for now, I think just to stay posted, to follow my Instagram and my Facebook, it's all Lyla June, to follow my Twitter, although I'm not the best tweeter, which is Lyla June 4NM, which stands for New Mexico. And to, you know, just stay involved with what I'm doing so that when the time comes, you know, we are all ready to mobilize to bring this Indigenous school to fruition. And a university that is of, for, and by Indigenous peoples, instead of like a tribal college, which is funded by, you know, Washington, D.C., and is beholden to a lot of rules and still, by and large, follows the same instructional methods as a Western university. And so we're excited about that. Yeah, I think that's what I'd say. If you want to buy my book, it's online. It's commonword.ca is the book publisher. The book's called Lifting Hearts Off the Ground. Yeah, I think
what's
that's
your,
it.
What's your website, just for folks?
LylaJuneJohnston.com, LylaJuneJohnston.com. And yeah, and just thank you for hosting this. I appreciate that.
Next Economy Now is a production of Lyft Economy. To listen to all of our episodes, go to lifteconomy.com/podcast. That's lifteconomy.com/podcast. You can also sign up for our monthly newsletter at lifteconomy.com/newsletter. Please also rate and review our podcast on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.